Good morning, good morning. How we doing, King's House? Man, it is so wonderful to see everyone here today. I am so excited about what God's going to be doing these next few weeks. And today we're kicking off a very special three-part series. And the name of this series is called Say So. And this series is based off of a verse out of Psalms 107. Put that verse up there for me, fellas. If you haven't noticed, we got some new technology today. And new technology is supposed to technically make your life easier, but in my experience, do I have a witness from the congregation? New technology makes my life complicated. Psalms 107 says it like this: "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good." Do I have a witness on that? Give thanks to the Lord because he is good. For his mercy endures, how long, King's House? Forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Look at your neighbor and say so. Man, the enemy, it seems like in this day and age, is working overtime. And he has a lot of things that he is trying to do and a lot of things that the enemy is trying to say in our world and in our society. And I think sometimes the church forgets who we are and who lives inside of us. Because my Bible, I don't know about your Bible, but my Bible says that the person living in me is greater than the person that's living in the world. You know what I'm saying? Do you believe that this morning, King's House? Man, I got a big Jesus and a big Holy Spirit living inside of me. And no matter what is going on in the world, how much chaos and confusion, and no matter what the enemy's trying to accomplish, I want you to know today there is a God in heaven who loves you, who is alive, who is well, who is seated at the right hand of God. He's not shaking in his boots. He's not concerned. He's not panicking. And man, God is still moving in this world, and God is still moving in our lives. God is still moving in the lives of the King's House, and it baffles me sometimes because the church just wants to pull back and shrink back and get into our little hole. But I'm telling you right now is the time for the church to rise up and say so, man, that God is alive. He is still the way, the truth, the life, the only way to heaven. And as you can tell, I'm a little excited this morning. And the best part is you don't even have to hear me preach this morning. That was too much. A little bit's okay, but that was too much. No, seriously, guys, I think you are going to be blessed today, and I just ask that you would just open up your heart today and the next few Sundays. Man, it's going to be so incredibly special, and the staff guys have put so much work into these next few Sundays. So if you would, one more time before we get started, would you just bow your heads and let me pray for you? God, I love you so much. I love you so much, God, and I thank you for everything that you've done. I thank you for everything that you're going to do. God, I thank you that the blessings in our lives so far outweigh any trial or any tribulation or anything negative going into our life. And God, as believers, we want to be reminded of your goodness and of your faithfulness. God, we want to be those people who are saying so to this world of the goodness and the faithfulness of our God. Lord, open our hearts today to receive all that you have for us. Minister to us today like only you can, Holy Spirit. We're going to give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Everybody said, hey, pay attention to these screens. We got a very special video for you this morning.
So tell me about Bradley pre-tumor.
Oh, he was a boy's boy. He would create his own mud holes in front of the yard, in the front yard, and play with tractors. And he would actually meet the trash man with my mother-in-law every Wednesday when they'd pick the trash up. And he'd take a lollipop out to him, a popsicle. And yeah, he's still fascinated with trash trucks.
Bradley was a hurricane, like life-size boy hurricane. Running, talking, jumping, climbing, hiding enough to make me freak out, and then he'll pop out. He loves his brothers. He's just a boy.
One day, on a Wednesday, October 9th, I picked him up from my in-law's house, and I knew that something didn't feel right, like God was telling me to get him to the hospital. So I called his doctors here in town, and they told me to go and get him to the emergency room. So we left and took him up to St. Francis. I had a real bad gut feeling something's wrong, because I could really feel like God was telling me to make this move, and I knew it was serious if God was telling me to get him up there.
They get him hooked up to all their machines. The doctor comes in, and within an hour of them doing the head CT scan, they came back into the room and told us it was a brain tumor the size of a lemon.
The first thing that went through my head when it happened was, I can't lose my baby. I love this kid more than life itself. Like, he's my world. And we do everything together. I get to spend so much time with him because of my work schedule that I don't get with my other kids or my wife. And he's just such a part of my daily routine, having him with me every moment, that I couldn't live without him. I knew at that moment that I couldn't do it, and it was time to start praying.
I was devastated. That's not something you ever want to hear about your child. I was bawling, and I called my cousin. And so the only words that she heard me say were, "Bradley, brain tumor," and then I'm bawling on the phone with her.
After that, we met with a doctor that was on call on that floor that had dealt with some brain tumors before, and he told us that this was one of the worst ones that he'd seen in a long time, and that they had called the surgeon in, Dr. Kai, and he was going to be meeting with us in a few hours.
They didn't know how long the surgery was going to last. It's just one of those things they didn't know until they got in there. Once they got in there, I would say they were back there for a good 8 hours. When they got in there, they noticed the tumor was very vascular, and every time they'd try to cut into it to remove it, he would end up bleeding. It got to the point where he was losing so much blood so fast they couldn't give him more blood fast enough, and his temperature had dropped so low they almost declared him dead on the table.
This whole time I'm texting Tiffany, Bradley's aunt, just trying to find out what's going on with this poor little boy. And my heart, as you can imagine, is just breaking for this family. I've known the family for many years, and to see anyone have to go through something like this is just, it's just tragic. And I'll never forget October the 15th, Hannah and I drove to Tulsa to go see Bradley and his family. He was going in for this first procedure. And walking in, you don't know what to expect. In your mind, you're so hopeful. I'm a pastor, I'm a believer. I should be so hopeful, but yet there's the carnal side that says, what is the reality of what's going to happen here today? And the whole time, I just remember thinking, God, do something. I want to see a miracle. I want to see something happen in this boy. I'll never forget seeing the look on the doctor's face as the family asked, what now? And it was disbelief in his eyes. It was a look of sadness. It was a look of hopelessness. And I remember just thinking, how in the world could this be? This is a little boy. This is God's boy.
They only got out about 40% of the tumor, which was not what they were expecting. They wanted to go in and take it all out. But due to the bleeding and his blood pressure dropping and his temperature dropping, they ended up having to stop it earlier than they wanted. When they decided to fly us to Memphis, they did not have the full pathology report back, so they weren't even sure what kind of cancer he had. They kept throwing out several different kinds. It could be this, or it could be this. But they said they would take us to St. Jude's anyway, and that they'd already contacted St. Jude's and they were aware of our case and waiting for us to get there. It was a medical jet, and it looked like the inside of a hospital room. It had all of your oxygen hookups, all of the IV poles. It has specialized cabin to hold the pressure so you wouldn't feel the altitude changes.
What kind of tumor Bradley has? It's a rare disease. It's not very common. We don't see it. It's not something that walks into your door all the time. It's extremely rare, right? So in our institution, during my time over here, we have had about 6 to 7 patients with his kind of tumor. The type of the tumor is his kind, but the size of Bradley's tumor, I would say I have not seen in my limited experience of few years. Maybe Dr. Robinson has seen a bigger tumor than that, but Bradley's tumor was very big in size. Just the size was very big.
We looked at the scans with our neurosurgeon, and we felt like he was so in such kind of tenuous situation that it would be better to try chemotherapy before trying to take it out again, because it was almost looked like it was bleeding within the brain.
That's when we started talking to Rachel and Adam at that time about, you know, we are running out of options right now. And that was a true statement, because now giving him chemotherapy is putting him at risk, because he had a seizure during chemotherapy, and we really cannot surgically remove it.
At some point or another, while we were in the hospital, all the doctors kept telling us that more likely than not, Bradley was going to be a vegetable for the rest of his life if he was to live and pull through with the amount of brain damage that he had. And I told them not to worry about that, that was God gave him to us, and we're going to raise him how God wanted him to be, and that God could restore him, and that, you know, me and his mom took him no matter what he was like. That he was ours, and their job was just to help make him better, and that's what I wanted them to do.
Actually, I remember the ICU. I mean, he was very sick, and the ICU calling me at about 9 or 10 o'clock at night, and I was just discussing the kind of a game plan. What do you think we should do? Should we do this or that? And I asked that, do you want me to come in? And I just went in at around 10:30 at night, because I just thought at that time that I'll probably not see Bradley the next day. Mm-hmm. And because it was that critical, because I remember I called Dr. Robinson and I said that, do you think I should just go in? Because I'm just worried that he won't be here tomorrow morning.
I thought it could have possibly been the last day I'd see my son alive and get a hold of him and know that he'd hear me tell him that I love him. And as soon as I got up there, I told him that I loved him. And, you know, I prayed before he went in for his second brain surgery. You know, I told God then that I thank God for giving me Bradley and for every day that I'd had with him. And I wouldn't be mad at him if he took him, because I'd want him to. And so I knew then that I had to let it go. And I had to let God do what he was going to do, because I'd already had a gift that I wish everybody in the world could experience, because that boy is so precious.
In this process, I remember being in my office one day, just working like normal, and I get a text from Blake saying, hey, the family is saying that they're going to be taking Bradley off of life support today, and they don't expect him to live within 30 minutes of them taking it off. And I continued to work, as I would say, prayers under my breath and in my heart for the family, but I just couldn't shake an urgency inside of me. And as the morning went on, and Blake texted once again saying, it's just a few more minutes before they take him off the ventilator, I remember just having to get up out of my office. I grabbed my guitar, and I walked into one of our empty office rooms, and I began to just worship. And I just began to cry out for Bradley and for the family. I began to intercede, and I've never really done this before for somebody, but everything started to just flow out of me. Like, you don't have to pray and work for the prayer. Like, it just started coming out of me, declaring life over him, declaring that he was gonna live, declaring that he was going to be a miracle in the making, that doctors were gonna be astounded. And I just remember spending what felt like only 5 minutes, ended up being about 45 minutes in that room just worshiping and praying. And I remember feeling God's presence so tangibly in there. I'm crying my eyes out on behalf of this young little boy. And when I walked out of that room, I remember having this sense of faith being stirred up and built inside of me that whatever's going to happen is going to happen, because God has a plan and a purpose for it.
Thank you.
I mean, everybody was there with the idea that we were going to watch him pass away. And, you know, we never know in medicine how quickly these things are going to happen. But in my mind, I didn't think it was going to be very long. I mean, I thought it was going to be probably a matter of hours after we extubated him that he would have some breathing difficulties. We'd be supporting him with whatever we could in order to make things comfortable, but he would pass away. And so we were all around. He extubated, and Bradley, being Bradley, was stubborn and doing relatively well from the breathing standpoint, right? He's not moving, he's not interacting, but he's breathing, and his heart rate is good, and his blood pressure was good. And so, you know, at that point, we spent a couple of hours with the family, and then we left them to be together, and, you know, made sure that we were on call and checked on him 3 or 4 times during the day and before we left at night. It didn't surprise us that he lived an hour, but I didn't expect him to be around the next day.
Yes, we were not expecting. I said bye-bye to Bradley before I left that day, so. But he's still here.
Dr. Robinson told me before he left that day, I told him, you know, he said, well, Bradley's stable right now. I said, okay, he's stable. I said, so you go put a plan together and I'll see you Monday. And he said, no, he said, we're going to take this real slow. He said, we'll get something together. He said, I'll tell you what, if he's doing okay by Monday, if we have any signs that there's any life in him, any willful movement from out of his brain, then we'll go ahead and do another scan and we'll figure something out. I said, okay. And it was a long weekend, but I told him, I talked to Bradley and prayed for him a lot. We all did. And we got some little movements out of his fingers like this. And it was when we would talk to him. And if you stopped talking, he'd get quiet, he'd stop moving. But you could talk to him again or play music and he'd start moving his fingers again. And then we got a few twitches out of his toe. Dr. Robinson came in Monday and he said, how was y'all's weekend? I said, well, it's been intense. And he said, it was for me too, because I've been sitting in front of my computer waiting to see what was going on with Bradley. And he said, I told you if he showed any improvement, we'd do something. He said, he's showing improvement. He said, it's not much or nothing. He said, I'm going to have to fight with him downstairs to get it approved for him to have the scan, because they think it's a lost cause. And we have people that we know we can help that they need the machines for. I said, please do the scan. And he said, we'll do it tomorrow. He said, but I'm going to tell you right now, in Bradley's state, I'm 100% certain. He said, I'm almost 100% certain it's going to kill him, putting him on the elevator. I said, well, I'm 100% certain he's going to die if we just sit here and don't do anything. So let's take him downstairs and do the scan.
And then Adam and Rachel will tell you, you know, a whole host of stories, because they would play him music. And sometimes, I mean, and I'm sure they knew, but, you know, they would tell me that he moved his arm to a beat or something, and wasn't that a good thing? And I was kind of like, well, that was probably some, you know, I'm thinking doctor terms, it was probably some reflex, it wasn't real, he's not doing this consistently. But every day there was something new.
Every day, we kept thinking it is a wishful statement from the parents.
Right. And then I was like, well, maybe they're onto something. Maybe, you know, and then in the back of our mind, we're giving him this medicine and we're thinking, well, maybe it's shrinking the tumor and maybe he is coming back. But at the same time, I wanted to keep my, you know, scientific brain intact and be like, don't get over hopeful here. You know, what's really going on?
One day when he was licking his tongue, Adam gave him a drop of Dr. Pepper. And he just kind of gobbled it up.
So you witnessed that?
Yes. Well, I didn't witness the first time because he sneaked it, because he was not allowed to eat or drink anything. But the next day when I was visiting him, Adam said that, Dr. Aditi, you want to see this? And he gave him it was not a drink, but he kind of took a sponge and dipped it and gave the Dr. Pepper in his mouth. And this kid is like drinking it up. And I'm like, and it was the first purposeful movement we saw in him. Like, okay, Dr. Pepper it is, give it to him. I don't mind.
We went in that Tuesday, which was the 12th, and they did the scan. And as soon as the scan results came back, they told us it'd take several hours for the radiologists to read the reports and get back with them. And within like 30 minutes of us being back in the room, the doctors came and they're like, everybody who wants to see this, come with us. And which was really weird. I'm like, oh, well, hopefully this is good, because we've done this in Tulsa a couple weeks ago. And so we all rushed into this room and they piled us all in. And the doctor's pointing things out on the tumor, and we got to talking with each other. He goes, man, you really have a good understanding of this stuff. And I explained to him I was a cancer survivor myself. And anyhow, we got to talking, and I told him, he said, we don't know how, but it shrunk. And he said, we think it was a residual from the chemo that was left in his body. I said, well, I think it's all the prayers. I said, we're going to keep praying, and what are we going to do now? He said, well, if you guys are willing to sign the waivers, we'll start him on the experimental chemo. From that day forward, they did scans about every 2 weeks. We did one at like 7 days, and then it was then we did one at like 10 days, and after that it was every 2 weeks they'd do a scan. And I'd ask the doctors something. I said, you know, how long do you think it'll take before we start seeing any real results from this chemo? They said, we have no idea, because we've never use it for something quite like this before. We were really not sure what to expect. And after Bradley started showing signs of improvement and stuff, anytime I'd ask him a question how long it normally takes for someone to do something, they'd say, well, for your average patient, we would tell you 6 months, but with Bradley, maybe by the time we get back from lunch this afternoon or maybe in the morning, he'll be doing it.
Range of emotions from hearing the doctors say that there was nothing else we could do to Bradley nodding his head along to his favorite song is almost indescribable. I think I hit every emotion there is, from happiness to also being worried at the same time.
Big someday, you got mud on your face, big disgrace, buddy, better put you back into your place. We will rock you.
One of my thoughts was that, what I said, when he didn't pass away, I was actually quite worried that he was brain dead, and that we were taking care of a kid who didn't have brain function. And I'm thinking about the horrible situation of Adam and Rachel having to care for an incapacitated kid. What gave me the greatest kind of relief and hope was a couple of weeks down the line. I mean, I would, you know, come home and lose sleep at night over the fact that I didn't know if I was actually helping him live in an incapacitated state or if he was going to come around. And so I think the greatest relief for us was then to just start to see this kind of daily minuscule improvement. To just know that there was somebody in there.
Sit, cover one eye up like you ain't looking up, and then you just peep out, okay?
She gonna let me poop in your pamper, ain't she, Brad?
So you gonna put that in a toilet? So, ooh, stank. That stank.
Look, we gonna surprise her, okay?
All right, Brad. I'll be back tomorrow to see you, okay?
The day before, I think a couple of days before Christmas, Giles was already, Dr. Robinson was already gone for vacation. He was about to leave for vacation. And I went in to see, and Bradley was still inpatient, so I just went in to see because, you know, we were closing down for Christmas. I wanted to go and wish him And he had just kind of woken up at that time. He was talking, you know, he was not walking yet, but he was talking. And we still had a DNR order on him in our file, right? And Adam was there. And at that time, Adam told me that, Dr. Aditi, what do you think about removing the DNR order for him? He should be resuscitated now. So he is my first patient in my entire career for whom I have actually removed the DNR order from the chart. And nobody knew how to do it. We know how to put the DNR in, but really nobody knows how to take the DNR out of a chart. So it took a little time for me to figure this out, how to take it. But he's my only patient, and that's how I'll probably always remember him, my first patient from whom I think we removed the DNR. And I texted Dr. Robbins immediately, you know, this is a Christmas gift for us.
Yeah.
Right?
How great.
How great is it?
And he actually told the doctors right after he had woke up and sat up and started talking again that Jesus healed him. Jesus took his tumor away. I knew when we went in for this last surgery, like I was, had a little bit of, a little scared like any parent would be, but at the same time I was like, no, if he's certain it's gone, then I have to be. We took Bradley to have this last surgery where they got the rest of the tumor out, and the doctor comes out after they'd done the surgery and he sets us in a room. And he goes, I have to tell you honestly, I never thought I'd be here. I never thought I'd see Bradley again. I didn't think there was anything that we're ever going to be able to do. He said, that tumor is so dead. He said, I don't see this with conventional chemo. He said, not only is it dead, I got it all out. He said, we're confident. We got 100%. He said, I've got one little spot I got to go back in and look at. He said, but I think it's just calcium buildup and scar tissue from all the surgeries. But he said, this is absolutely amazing, guys. He said, I never thought that we would be here in this place today. He said, I'm so happy for y'all. And that was awesome. Absolutely awesome.
I mean, it's absolutely incredible. We would never have really thought that we would see this boy
walk into the clinic.
Walking, yeah. I mean, but even, I mean, we would have been happy with eye opening and
coming in a wheelchair and some movements,
you know, some ability to communicate. I mean, to watch him make a nearly complete recovery is just the most amazing thing. And then, I mean, you know, what we've been able to do up until this point, and his journey's not over, and it won't be over for a long time. We'll keep watching him extremely closely. I mean, getting now to the point where we were able to remove kind of the last remnants of that tumor, because it had shrunk down to next to nothing, but there were still kind of remnants in there, and then Dr. Booth, the same surgeon, went in and has been able to take that out. So we're incredibly hopeful that will give them a lasting kind of remission.
The 1st of August, we went back for a follow-up checkup, and they did a scan on Bradley. And they said they feel that they've got all the tumor. They had one little spot they're worried about. They think it's just calcium buildup. They're monitoring it. But other than that, we were able to stop the chemo. And they think he's tumor-free and cancer-free. And they said that this particular tumor has a real low rate of reoccurrence once it's all successfully removed. And he told us that because of what Bradley's been through and with him being able to get all the tumor out and being able to do all the blood work every step like they did and getting all the different scans, that this could be a real game changer for chemo for a lot of people, because this chemo has no side effects other than hunger and weight gain. He did not get nauseous from it. He did not ever throw up. They call it traditional chemo, what traditional chemo does to you. And they said that this experimental drug could be the new wave and really just help change a lot of lives.
King South, would you stand to your feet this morning? and welcome the one and only Bradley Lawson. Oh my goodness. Is God good or what? Take a seat. Bradley, how are you this morning? Are you good? Bradley, can you tell me how old you are?
My birthday.
Four? And you just started school, I heard. Is that going good? School's going good. Bradley, I need to tell you something. Did you know that all these people out here have been praying for you while you were sick? Did you know that? Can you tell all these guys thank you?
Thank you.
Hey, Bradley, one more question. Do you think you can tell us who healed you when you had a tumor?
Jesus.
Adam and Rachel, I'm sure it's just been an incredible journey. I can't imagine all the emotions and what all you went through. And just hearing your story and visiting with you the past few weeks, like, your faith has inspired me. What does it feel like to be sitting here this morning with this little healthy boy? He's on a mic too, Blake.
It's amazing. It's everything. It's absolutely amazing to be here with him this morning. It's everything I dreamed of when he was laying in the hospital sick, that one day we'd get to get out and share this story and just show how great our God is and how much he loves us and cares for us.
Hey, Bradley. Somebody told me that you like dinosaurs and Dr. Pepper. Is that true? Dinosaurs and... I have a little surprise for you this morning, Bradley. Do you like surprises? Look. Lean forward and look over here. Can you see that? Look, Bradley. A dino bringing you Dr. Pepper. Mr. T-Rex, you can just set it right there somewhere. Careful, T-Rex, careful. Hey, Bradley, I have a very special message for you this morning that somebody very special sent to you. Bradley, would you like to watch a message this morning from someone very... Hey, what? Look right up here on this screen. There's going to be a special message for you this morning.
Hi, Bradley. It's Dr. Robinson here. We're so proud of you, and this is such a special day for you. Thank you so much for coming to us. Our world has been enriched to have you in it. Rachel and Adam, it's so good to have seen you on the video. I'm so happy for you guys, and we can't wait to see you again soon here at St. Jude.
Hi, Bradley. It's Dr. Aditi, and... I have had a great, great time with you, and it's so much fun when you are around, and I miss seeing you over here. So we'll see you soon, and Rachel and Adam, the video was lovely. We really, really enjoyed it.
Hi, Bradley.
That's fantastic. Fantastic. Hey, Bradley. What, Bradley, one more... He is not intimidated of this spotlight one little bit. You might grow up and be a preacher, you think, Bradley? Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Hey, I got one more surprise for you. The same person who told me that you liked dinosaurs and Dr. Pepper also told me... Yeah, Dr. Pepper. You really like Dr. Pepper. That same person told me that you also like tractors and Spider-Man. Is that true? Tractor and well, look who's coming on. You want to go say hi to Spider-Man? You can. Go give Spider-Man a hug. Oh, my goodness. You got a tractor, Bradley. Hey, can you sit on there real fast and see if it's going to fit? Help him up there, Spider-Man. We got to get this thing home and get you out in the yard this afternoon. Woo! No, you just sit right there. Rachel, Adam, Bradley, I'm so happy to have you here this morning. It's incredible. I really don't know what else to say this morning. There's not a lot of times in my life I'm at a loss for words, but it really is incredible. And thank you for your faithfulness, and thank you for sharing your story. And man, I feel confident that it has built some faith in this room this morning. And Adam, I just want to give you an opportunity just to say a few words to the King's House and the people who are watching. There's people watching this morning in Costa Rica. There's people watching this morning in Canada. There's people watching this morning all over the world. So just take a few minutes and just whatever you want to say, Mr. Adam.
We just really want to thank you, everybody that's followed Bradley's story and prayed for him. We want to let everybody know at St. Jude's that we absolutely love y'all. Dr. Didi and Dr. Robinson, thank you so much. And we really just want to give all the glory to God and thank you for healing our son today. Thank you all very much for being here.
King's House, would you stand one more time and give it up for this family? We'll get your tractor in just a little bit, buddy, I promise. Give it up for him, King's House. Praise team, will you come on down? Praise team, you guys can take a very brief seat if you would. Praise team, would you come on up? What a incredible story, and what an incredible day. And I am so happy to report to each and every person this morning that we serve a God who's not dead, but we serve a God who is very alive today. And the Bible says that He is the same yesterday, today, and the same God forever. There's a lot of questions in life. And I don't have a lot of answers to those. I don't know why we pray for some people and they don't get healed the way we want them to. I don't understand why. And today is a joyous, wonderful day. But it can also be something bittersweet for maybe some of us sitting in this room today. We needed a miracle. We prayed. And for whatever reason, we didn't get that miracle. And I'm not going to stand up here today and try to pretend like I understand some of those things. What I do know is that God's ways are higher than my ways, that God's thoughts are so much higher than my thoughts, that He sees the end of the story from the beginning of the story, that He sees. There's just so many things that are beyond my understanding, that are beyond my comprehension. But one thing I do know for certain today is that God is still a God who is doing miracles today. I believe that wholeheartedly. I don't understand why they don't always happen. I don't understand why some people get... I don't understand all those things, but I know that there is a God who is alive, who is powerful, and who is still doing miracles today. I believe that wholeheartedly. I believe wholeheartedly He is not a respecter of persons. I believe that what he has done for Bradley, he can do for you and your loved one. It doesn't differentiate how good you are or how bad you are. Or you can't earn his love. You can't earn his blessings. You can't earn his faith. He loves you just because he loves you. And there's no strings attached in this love of Jesus. And I would be willing to bet today that there are some people in this room today that have some needs in your life. And you would say, Pastor Mark, I need a miracle today. Maybe some of you today need a miracle in your finances. Maybe some of you today you would say, Mark, my marriage is falling apart. I mean, this thing is a wreck. It's beyond counseling. It's beyond, Mark, I need a miracle today. I know someone who's still in the miracle business this morning. Maybe some of you are sick in your body this morning. You've done everything that you know how to do. You say, Mark, I need a miracle. Maybe it's a loved one. I don't know what's going on in your world. This room is full of people this morning, and I know we're all facing all sorts of situations and circumstances and going through all kinds of trials. But no matter the situation, no matter the circumstance, no matter the trial that you're going through, no matter the problem, I want you to know this morning that the answer is always the same. His name is Jesus. The same answer. And I believe that very same Jesus is right here in this room this morning. I feel his presence here with us today. And I believe that as the prayer team comes this morning, I just want to give each and every one of you an opportunity. If you would just all stand with me this morning, and as the prayer team comes, I want to give you an opportunity. Pastor Mark, I need a miracle in my life today. I'm going to ask you that as the worship team begins to play this next worship song, that if you need a touch from God today, if you need a miracle from heaven today, that you would just begin to make your way down to this front. Listen, we have time. We have nowhere else that we need to be or nothing else that we need to do. I want to give you an opportunity. I don't care what your need is this morning. I don't care how big. I don't care how small. Whatever your need is this morning, I just want to invite you as the worship team worships, that whatever your need is, just to come to this altar and give God an opportunity to move in a miraculous way in your life, just like he moved in a miraculous way in Bradley's life. Would you just bow your heads with me this morning? Man, if you're here this morning and you would say, Pastor Mark, I need a touch from God today. I need a miracle. I need a miracle in my body. I need a miracle in my finances. I need a miracle in my marriage. I need a miracle in my relationships with my kids or my family. I need a miracle at work. Pastor Mark, I need a miracle today. If that's you, would you just raise your hand all across this room? Man, Pastor Mark, I'm talking with some boldness this morning. Pastor Mark, I need a miracle today. God, you see every hand that's going up around this room. And God, I just ask that you would begin to stir their hearts right now. God, I just ask you begin to move their hearts right now. That you begin to move on their behalf, Holy Spirit. And God, I just want to thank you that we're going to see some miracles happen in this room today. As the worship team plays, would you come if you need prayer this morning?